Today in my book, In Ineffable Attributes, we will be going through God's justice. And justice means to make right. So Hebrews 10:30 says, "For we know him who said, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay.' And again, 'The Lord will judge his people.'" God's justice is found within his love. Justice comes from him who is holy, and God alone is the holy, perfect, pure one, and he can't even look upon sin. And we know that scripture makes it very clear that those who want nothing to do with God in this life, God is not going to force them to live with him in the afterlife, because God is a God who is both love and full of justice. And on that final day, final judgment, during when we all go before the great white throne, God's justice will be seen and declared in full. Because we may struggle as David did in this life. "Lord, how come the wicked prosper?" And we know that nothing escapes God. And those who are unrepentant of their lifestyles and sins, they are going to be cast into the lake of fire. And we know that God did not make hell for mankind or for humans. He made it for Lucifer and his demons. But those who continue in the way of Lucifer and his demons, those who go their own way, who want nothing to do with God, who want to live in sin and completely fulfill all that is contrary to God, God will have justice done on that final day. Because every transgressor who is unrepentant, every wicked person, whether they were swindlers in this age, whether they were extremely prideful and selfish, whether they were perverters from the pulpits who declared their own truths and neglected the word of God, whether they were those who constructed man-made religions and constructed man-made idols and believed them to be God, those who continually pumped out the filth of pornography, those who were caught up in sex trafficking, those who were just lazy in this life and expected everything to just be handed to them, God is going to cast those people into the lake of fire if they are unrepentant. But thanks be to God, we know he desires mercy. And for those of us who are born again and have believed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and repented of our sins, we have entered into newness of life. We know that we are saved solely by what Christ has done, and God desires to save all. But he gives us the choice to choose him or to choose to reject him. And so we know that vengeance is the Lord. He will repay. And so that is why there is a hell, there is a lake of fire. And anyone who believes in universalism is entirely misled. They have bought into a man-made ideology that is entirely contrary to the scriptures and what the Spirit of God has revealed. Because we know that universalism, right out the gates, anyone who believes that everyone is going to go to heaven, automatically it condones and says we can live however we want in this life. We can indulge in our sin, we can do whatever we want. But hey, it doesn't matter. We're all going to make it to heaven. We're all one big happy family, right? I may have killed you in this life. I may have raped you in this life. And I don't even need to be sorry about it, but because we're all going to end up in the same spot. That is entirely contrary to the scriptures and what God has revealed. Hitler, Stalin, the transgressors of all the ages, as we already mentioned, the wicked, the sinful, unrepentant sinners, selfish men and women who want nothing to do with God, they will be cast into the lake of fire where there is weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Hell is not a torturous place. There aren't pitchforks and knives and axes and torture racks and any of that. It is the torment of living with oneself for all eternity. It is the torment of being in this place of self-absorption, where there is a darkness that can be felt, where there is no love, there is nothing of the presence of God, God's presence is extracted, anything that is joyous and happy and peaceful and love and good and beautiful is non-existent in hell, it is all extracted. It is a place where men will cry and beg for death, but death will flee from them. It is a place where men and women will burn in their lusts forever and ever. It is a place where the worm dieth not, as the last chapter in Isaiah says, where the mind is continually warped back to time, all the times they could have repented and accepted Christ, but then they didn't, And then they're immediately brought back into hell, this place where there is no socializing. They're completely by themselves forever. Hell is a horrific place that God does not want to send anyone. But nonetheless, his justice will not allow people who wanted nothing to do with him, those who went against him in all regards, those who neglected and rejected his call time and time again, those who harmed his children in this life, God is not going to let them go to heaven. He is not going to let them off the hook. He will send them to the lake of fire. And we need to know that God's justice is a blessing. We don't want anyone to go to hell in this life. We, as born-again believers, we want everyone to come to know Christ and to come to repent of their sins, because we are not perfect. We have done nothing to earn our salvation. We merely have believed in Christ and repented of our sins. And God desires for all to come to know him. He doesn't make people to damn them. That is entirely contrary to Scripture. Wherever God places a person who is going to be damned, he foreknows that that person is going to freely reject him in all regards. We know even that God sent Christ into this world. And God in flesh, performing miracles, was seen by the Pharisees, and the Pharisees wanted nothing to do with him. They wanted to be self-righteous. They wanted to see him crucified. And that just shows validation and proof that it doesn't matter if even Christ revealed himself to someone. There are just some people that are going to say, no, I don't want to go your way, God. I don't want to know you. I want to do what I want to do. I am my God. And that was the fall of garden, is to think that we could be God, to think that we can determine our own right and wrong. We can determine what is good and what is evil. And the reality is there is only one good, pure being who declares and knows the difference between good and evil and remains unaffected by the knowledge of it. Because God, although he knows what evil is, he is unaffected by it. He can't even look upon evil, Scripture says. And God does not want us to live in evil. He knows there are consequences. Everything that is sin listed in the Bible, there's a consequence to it. And God makes this known to us. He calls us to get away from sin and to turn to him. He is willing to forgive us, to guide us along this life as we progress in the faith. He knows we're not going to be perfect. But some people want to live in their sin. And yet God at the same time is saying, look, I have sent this my son to die on the cross for your sins. Just believe in me and repent. Turn to me. To go that way is going to lead to ultimately destruction and damnation. But some people just will not turn because they love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. So we need to know that God is truly calling all, but his justice, his wrath is found in his justice, and his justice is found within his love, because he is going to have everything done on that final day, because he is the one who can judge the living and the dead. He is the one who can cast both body and soul in hell. He is the ultimate absolute authority. He is the Holy One of Israel, and he is the one whom we should fear, who can cast both body and soul in hell. And he is the one whom we should fear when we are born again, as we work out, not work for our salvation, but work out our salvation in fear and trembling. He is the one that wants people to know him, but he has blessed us with the gift of libertarian free will. And even in the making and creating of people, he knows that there is always going to be people that are going to sadly reject him and will be cast in the lake of fire on that final day. So as always, we will end with one of the five quotes at the end of each chapter. And this one is from Thomas Watson. He says, "There's justice in hell, but sin is the most unjust thing. It would rob God of his glory, Christ of his purchase, the soul of its happiness." That's so true. If God's justice wasn't there and he merely excused anything and everything and there was no call to obey him and to repent of our sins, it would rob him of his glory and holiness. It would rob Christ of doing what he did. I mean, if universalism was true and everyone was going to heaven, why in the world would God send his son to die on the cross? We are fully responsible for sending Christ on the cross, and we are fully responsible for choosing to accept or reject the general revelation that God gives, knowing that there is a God who exists by merely looking at creation, or the specific revelation, getting a chance to hear the gospel and to hear the name of Christ and to know that he died on the cross for our sins. We are fully responsible for what God gives us. And may we just pray that all would come to know him. God desires mercy, but nonetheless, he's not going to excuse his justice and wrath on that final day. He's not going to allow sin in this life. Those who unrepentant sinners who harmed and wronged us and his people, he's not going to let sin go unexcused. But thanks be to God that he's provided the way to be saved from our sins. The question is will we accept what Christ has done for us, and will we repent of that which sent Christ to the cross?